हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, सो वेलकम टू दिस पर्टिकुलर सेशन. स्टूडेंट्स, ऑल ऑफ यू विल नाउ कंफर्म क्विकली स्टूडेंट्स अबाउट दिस. प्लीज पुट द लेक्चर इन द ग्रुप इटसेल्फ, इन आवर व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप पुट द लिंक. So students, let's start then. Good evening, Nishank, Priya. Good evening to all of you. So students, we will now first wrap up this 112A. That section, and then 50C, and thereafter I will do with you quickly the gift tax. This is what we targeted now. I will have to leave, but I have taken the permission till 9:15 or so, because at least we have to complete this particular area so that there is a logical conclusion of our discussion. So I will not take much time, and then we can just quickly run through now. All of you take your module. I think it is also there in the chart, but I'll just still go with the module part right now, because chart always you can revise it. Last lecture we have done the 54 series. Hopefully you all would have gone through it. So what is now left, students, for our discussion here is about this 112A, the last particular thing, and 50C, and that will cover up the capital gains itself. Again, I'm repeating, students, primarily the revision pattern in which you are going to revise your capital gains. If you remember, I have already have given you the checklist, initial the chart I have prepared for you, and we were discussing the charging section. What is the charging section, which are the, I have given you the list of that. Thereafter, the second one was about the cases which is not considered to be a taxable transfer, isn't it? Like we have seen about the death case. Thereafter, the the next particular part, we also have looked upon the amalgamation, demerger, something of that sort also we have discussed. I have also tick mark all the things from the module itself, what you need to only remember for your capital gains as far as your examinations are concerned. Next part in our discussion was the stump sale, which we have discussed, a computation particular provision, and finally the exemptions is the tax rates. I have given you that particular chart. Just follow that chart, students, for your revision purpose. The way we have done for that massive PGBP revision, same way here also you will do the same way. With that, now let's look upon to this special tax rate as well. Last lecture we have also discussed 112 and also 111A, isn't it? And in that 111A and 112, we have discussed some very specific combination. I have also given to all of you quite some situation, some case studies for all of you for working out the solution. Hitika Gopal, good evening. So keep those in mind, because that will definitely will help you to negotiate the tricky MCQs which would be there in your examination. So even that will be taken care of well for all of you. With that, now let's start with 112A, concessional rate of tax in respect of LTCG on transfer of certain assets. In order to minimize the economic distortion and curb erosion of tax base, Section 112A provides that notwithstanding anything contained in Section 112, a concessional rate of tax at 10% will be leviable on the long-term capital gains exceeding rupees 1 lakh on the transfer of an equity shares, equity-oriented fund, or a unit of business trust. So, students, all these things you just remember like this for your IPCC. Obviously, when we will do in final C, we will do a very advanced discussion on this. But just for your IPCC level, what is required for you to know is like this. Short-term capital gains on the same securities, 111A. Long-term capital gains on the same security, 112A. What happens in 111A? You have 15% rate. What happens here in 112A? It is 10%. Now, however, 112A has got a very specific mode of giving you the computation. Very, very specific mode of giving you the computation. You will say, sir, what is its specific mode? That they, it says that in spite of the fact that it's a long term in nature, first thing is no indexation benefit would be allowed, students. No indexation benefit will be allowed. Okay, why no indexation benefit is allowed? Because the rate that we are charging to you on this is the reduced rate of 10%. The rate that we are charging to you on this is the reduced rate of 10%. And because it is the reduced rate of 10%, therefore they say that we will not give you the indexation benefit. Students, if you remember in the last lecture of 112, I told you rarest of the rare case, they may ask you that particular question. If you remember on that listed security and the zero coupon bond, this one, 1% chance, listed security, which was there and the zero coupon bond. So here there is an option which has been there. Here there is an option which has been given to you, and the option is what? Either you take the indexation at 20%, either you go with the indexation and charge 20% tax on the long-term capital gains, or you don't go for the indexation and charge 10% tax rate on that particular capital gains. That is what, students, I have discussed with all of you in the last lecture, although this probability is very less. Okay, but still keep in mind, because it's there in your module, and ICAI have, because this is also we have done in our examination in our inter CA as well. So we do knew this thing. Okay, somebody will say, sir, then what is the difference between this listed security and zero coupon? Students, if you see over here they are targeting what? Shares. And this is listed where? In a recognized stock exchange. So the difference between this, if you see the condition over here, primarily, this is about, in the case of equity shares in a company, STT has been paid. So when you talk about STT, STT is paid when the shares, Balakrishnan, good evening. The shares are listed in a recognized stock exchange. The shares are listed in a recognized stock exchange. Fine, only then the STT is paid. So there it was about listed security. Now that can be listed anywhere. Anywhere means whether it is a recognized stock exchange or unrecognized stock exchange. Like there are many unrecognized stock exchange in India. Okay. And so therefore, in respect of that, 112 will apply. Fine. And also 112 is applicable for security. The word security is very comprehensive as compared to the term shares. Here they are talking only about equity shares. What about preference shares? For preference shares, where it will go? Then it will go over 112. For preference shares, where it will go? It will go in 112, because that covers, but provided again that if the preference shares are listed, and if the preference shares are listed, then that option of with indexation 20%, without indexation 10% would be available. The option of with indexation 20%, without indexation of 10% will be available. So students, that is what it is. But that 1% chance which I'm telling you, you don't get confused. If you still think that it looks very dicey for you that with indexation 20% and without indexation 10%, if you still feel dicey, just omit it. But this is the distinction which I have to tell you between 112A and that option which is available in 112 with indexation 20, without indexation 10. So coming back on this particular front, if you look here now, as I told you, students, as far as your IPCC is concerned, inter CA is concerned, you will only look upon this combination like this, that if it is short term for these securities, if it is short term in nature, you will go with 111A. If these securities are there, same securities, and it is long term, then you will go with 112A. Whereas if it is a short term, then in that case the rate would be 15%, and if it is a long term, then the rate would be at 10%, but without applying the indexation benefit. After this, students, one very important point is about 1 lakh threshold. Can you see this one? Adjustment. There is this 1 lakh exemption here. Sorry, just see this one, students. 10% will be leviable on the long-term capital gains exceeding rupees 1 lakh. That is the beauty of this. Gopal is asking whether this 1 lakh limit exemption is available for 112 also, and the answer is no. This is only dedicated exemption of 1 lakh meant for 112A. So if it is 111A special tax rate or 112 special tax rate, for these two special tax rate, you will not be getting the exemption of rupees 1 lakh. Keep this particular point in mind, students. And therefore, students, herein, in this case, 1 lakh is only for 112. If the case falls in 112A, only then this particular point would be applied. Please have a look to point number 3, students. If you remember this particular benefit of the unabsorbed basic exemption limit, we have seen and we have worked out for 111A, and also we have worked out for 112, that if there is any unabsorbed basic exemption limit, then in that particular case, the short-term capital gains of 111A or the long-term capital gains of 112 will be adjusted with the unabsorbed basic exemption limit. Now, shall I ask you again, how do you get this unabsorbed basic exemption limit? So students, you get this unabsorbed basic exemption limit by adjusting the normal income. The normal income, which is charged at the normal rate of tax, with the basic exemption limit. That is 2.5 lakhs or 3 lakhs, as the case may be. Now, after adjusting this normal income with the basic exemption limit, if there is there is still an unabsorbed basic exemption limit which is left out, then that unabsorbed basic exemption limit will be adjusted against what, students? Against the short-term capital gains which is chargeable under 111A, or long-term capital gains which is chargeable under 112. Now, whether this particular benefit will it be available, for 112A as well, for this, students? Point number 3, let's have a look then. In the case of a resident individual or HUF, if the basic exemption limit is not fully exhausted by any other income, what is this any other income, by the way? Again, what is this any other income? Any other income means the income chargeable income chargeable at the normal rate of tax. So let's read this one again. In the case of resident individual or HUF, please also underline the word resident, if the basic exemption limit is not fully exhausted by any other income, then such long-term capital gains exceeding rupees 1 lakh will be reduced by the unexhausted basic exemption limit, and only the balance would be taxed at 10%. However, the benefit of the adjustment of unexhausted basic exemption limit is not available in the case of non-residents. You will still make a silly mistake, students. I understand that, and therefore I'll put you across to one simple question. But before I put you across to a simple question, let's read this point number four. No deduction under chapter 6A against the long-term capital gains will be taxable under section 112A. What does it imply? It implies that the chapter 6A deduction, if you have got ATC deduction, ATD deduction, will that be available from this 112A income? And the answer is no. It will not be available from this 112A income. And finally, point number five. This is important, students. Can you see this point number five herein? This is important. No benefit of the rebate, students. No benefit of the rebate under section 87A against the long-term capital gains taxable under section 112A. Let me ask you, whether this particular rebate benefit, was it available? Was it available under 111A tax of the short-term capital gains or 112 tax of the long-term capital gains? Whether the rebate benefit, was it available over there? Quickly get me the answer. Gopal. Nishank, Priya. Indeed, students, indeed, the answer is yes. Primarily, we have seen, Pavan, we have seen that it was very much adjustable. It was very much adjustable with that particular income. So definitely we have reduced that primarily. Okay, so we have reduced that primarily. Now, but this is not available. So therefore, please make a note of this one, that rebate of 87A was available on tax under section 111A or 112. Tax under 111A and 112. Fine, students. I think that all of you are through with this one, with this one now. So now in that regard, so let me take this discussion further. All of you are through with this. This you are not supposed to do now. Only this much is required. Quickly, a quick small question I'm giving it to you. We'll do that so as to just making it ensure that whether you have understood this concept or not. And then we'll switch to 50C. So students, you can do it from your chart also, but primarily, which I'm saying that chart also we have given there, but I'm just doing it because these things have already have done it from here in your last lecture. Students, take this question. Mr. A. So Mr. A, who is a resident, definitely. If the question is silent, then always assume he is a resident. So business income is, say, rupees 2 lakhs, LTCG on securities, on equity shares. Listed on recognized stock exchange. Now for this, the selling price was rupees 5 lakhs and the cost was rupees 3 lakhs. Students, here, first of all, and also write the fair market value as on 31st of Jan 2018 the fair market value as on 31st January 2018 was rupees 2 lakhs runs. This 2 lakhs and make this as 3 lakhs. Okay. Chapter 6 deduction rupees 25,000. Chapter 6 deduction rupees 25,000. Now, if those students who are not aware of why I am taking this FMV, so I'll just give you the hint. The cost of the shares under section 112A, the cost part is higher of. Is higher of the two. This is what they have written. It is higher of the two. So you will not do the indexation part and you will take the higher of the two amounts. Okay? As your cost while you calculate the long term capital gains. You will take this as the higher of the two amount as your cost while you calculate the long term capital gains. So my request to all of you students is to calculate the tax liability. Let me see now. This is the last question before we move to the last concept, which is 50C. Please, all of you, and I want the tax till HEC. I want when you type your answer, I want the tax till HEC. Quickly. Nishank. Gopal. Last 30 seconds, students. Get the answer fast. Let's see then, students. What would be the answer then in this regard? So when you compute the total income, the PGP already computed is 2 lakhs. Priya, the capital gains is your selling price, which has been given to you as 5 lakhs. Now, the less the cost would be the higher of the two, and the higher amount is 3 lakhs. So, actual cost is compared with what? The actual cost, students, is compared with the fair market value as on 31st of Jan 2018. So, in the examination, also they will always give you this particular information, and therefore you have to take the higher of the two value, and that will become the cost for the purpose of the computation of the capital gains. So, in this regard, students, if you see, you get 2 lakhs, isn't it? And thereafter, you'll minus the threshold exemption amount. Exemption limit on this is 1 lakh. Exemption limit is 1 lakh because only beyond 1 lakh that the capital gains becomes chargeable. The capital gains under 112A. The capital gains under 112A becomes chargeable. So therefore, whatever is the long-term capital gains that you have calculated, primarily the long-term capital gains that you have calculated against that, 1 lakh would be the exempt amount, and therefore what goes out is then only 1 lakh further. Thereafter, students, you have your GTI of 3 lakhs, and finally chapter 6A, how much is that? 25,000. Now this 25,000 you are giving from what? You are giving from this. Be careful, because from LTCG this chapter 6A is not available. So you're talking about chapter 6A, you should know from which particular income that the deduction of chapter 6A is getting available to you. So that is one of the realization that you should always have. So 2.75 is your total income. Now in the total income of 2.75, I can say 1.75 lakhs finally is your normal income. 1.75 lakhs is your normal income, and 1 lakh happens to be your LTCG. 1 lakh happens to be your taxable LTCG. That will give you 2.7 lakhs as the total income. So now, students, what you will do is this, that in this context, less the, so therefore the tax, when you calculate tax liability, as we all know, the basic exemption limit of 2.5 lakhs, the basic exemption limit of 2.5 lakhs will fully be adjusted against what? Against this 1.75 lakhs of your normal income. And after that, what is left is this 75,000. After this, what is left is this 75,000. So that is how it has to be considered. So students, in this context, if you see very carefully, the tax liability that we are talking about, it is the LTCG. Which is how much? 1 lakh minus from this LTCG, 75,000. Which is, sir, from where you got this 75,000? Let me then give you the working of this. So 2.5 lakhs was the basic exemption limit, isn't it? 2.5 lakhs was the basic exemption limit, and from this 2.5 lakhs, what you have reduced? 1.75 lakhs of the normal income. So this is your amount. So 1 lakh minus, therefore you get 10% on 75,000, on 25,000, sorry. Which is 2,500. And add to this HEC at the rate of 4%. So therefore 4% you will put it across here, and that comes to, I think, 100. And therefore tax liability is This is a tax liability. If you know this particular point, students, we have also have discussed that if this would have been, if this would have been where in the, if the same would have been where, students, if the same would have been in the 112 case or 111A case, then will we be getting the benefit of the exemption limit? Will we be getting the benefit primarily of, sorry, will we be getting the benefit of the rebate of 87A? And the answer is yes. But the fact that the chargeability now is only in 112A, the chargeability, students, is under 112A, therefore there is no rebate that is available under section 87A. No rebate, students, whatsoever. Why no rebate whatsoever? Because just now we have seen, this, that the question of getting the rebate in this situation will not arise. The question of getting the rebate in this situation will not arise. We have seen this particular point over here, isn't it? So students, in this context, primarily, just be very careful, repeat those questions which I have taught you so as to get the build-up of this particular case studies. Okay, so all the questions, students, which I have taught you in 111A, 112 and 112A, do those small questions only. Because these, if you solve those three questions, I think we have done the three or four questions practically. If you solve this thing, you will know primarily what is the difference between what happens over here, what happens over there and all. So this question, please ensure that on the day of the examination also, please do it and then go. With that now, students, we go to our last concept on CG. And at least then we are through with their massive concept of the capital gains. Anyone can guide me to the page number quickly? It is already there over here. Students, there is this chart which has been available. So there are, this chart is handy for all of you. You do this much only will be sufficient. So mark this page number wherever it is. Now, students, 50C, this valuation. Gopal, towards the end, I'll answer this particular query. If anyone, let me answer it. If anyone has LTCG of rupees 3.5 lakhs under section 112A, having no other income, then no tax shall be levied. In this case, Gopal, the answer is yes, no tax shall be levied. So Gopal is asking that his LTCG finally calculated under 112A is 3.5 lakhs. Why? No tax will be levied because 1 lakh anyway, he will get the exemption of 112A. Within 112A, there is an exemption of 1 lakh. Isn't it? So therefore, after claiming the exemption of rupees 1 lakh, your taxable LTCG of 112A will be reduced to 2.5 lakhs. Your taxable LTCG of 112A will be reduced to 2.5 lakhs. And from that 2.5 lakhs, you will anyway get, you will anyway will get the basic exemption limit of 2.5 lakhs. And therefore, you will have your tax liability will be nil, because that long-term capital gains, the net or the taxable long-term capital gains of 2.5 lakhs will be fully be absorbed with the basic exemption limit of 2.5 lakhs. Considering your question, which where you have said that he does not have any other income. Okay, now students, please come to this particular part, 50C. First of all, in the examination, students, 50C is what they will ask you, 50C or maximum 50D. They will not ask you 50CA, 50CA, they will ask you in final CA. Let us see what is this 50C. So you can mark 50C and 50D if you want. Students, just for your clarification, I just wanted to tell you this because it is also there in PGBP. In your notes, I have seen in your PGBP module, they have covered 43CA. There is one section 43CA. You will say, sir, then what is the difference between 50C and 43CA? This is a difference. For me, students, land or building, as the case may be, it is like an investment for me. Land or building, it is like what? Investment for me. And because it is an investment for me, therefore what? Therefore, these particular assets which are being there, when I am transferring the same, when I am transferring the same, this will result into a capital gains. This will result into a capital gains. Now, when I have to calculate the capital gains for the real estate transaction as an investor, when I have to calculate the capital gains for this real estate transaction, then in that case, students, the full value of consideration shall be determined as per 50C. The full value of consideration shall be determined as per what? 50C. Okay, that is point number one. Point number two, students, if supposingly I'm not the investor, I am a dealer. You say, sir, what do you mean by dealer? Dealer means I am a developer or I am a builder. So for me, capital on the buying and selling of the real estate will not be chargeable in my hands under the head capital gains. On buying and selling of the real estate will not be chargeable in my hands under the head capital gains. It will be chargeable under the head PGBP. It will be chargeable under the head PGBP. Isn't it? So in that particular case, students, in that particular case, the capital gains that would be calculated in my hands, the capital gains that would be calculated in my hands in such particular situation, it will be, for me, if I'm a builder, it will be PGBP. If I'm an investor, it will be capital gains. Now, in both the cases, there is one thing which is common. What is a common feature? Being an investor, the full value of consideration will be as per 50C. And if I'm a dealer, so being a businessman in the real estate, for me, the selling price would be under 43CA. The selling price will be under 43CA. Okay. Now, whatever we are going to do it in 50C, the same concept applies in 43CA. But I'm telling you again, 43CA is applicable to whom? To the one for whom real estate is a stock in trade. For whom real estate is a stock in trade. Okay. But if you say, no, sir, real estate is not a stock in trade for me, fine. Then on the sale, you will be charged under the head capital gains. And what is the full value of consideration which will be adopted? That will be adopted as per 50C. So this is the fine distinction between the two that you should always keep in mind. This is the fine distinction between the two that you should keep in mind. And with that, then let's come to this particular proposition. All of you, land or building or both, 50C. Why this section I am doing it with you, students? Because immediately there is this IFOS, the gift tax. Whatever you do it for the seller, for the buyer you will find a nexus. Okay, and that is the reason why immediately after 50C you should do IFOS. And IFOS, what you should finish it off? Gift tax. That is the combination, student, that you should always adopt in your final revisions. Now you have to revise it smartly, isn't it? So capital asset, land or building or both, section 50C, fine. See the circumstances. First of all, if the stamp duty value is greater than 105% of the consideration received or accruing as a result of the transfer, then the stamp duty value. Now I'm just making this more sophisticated. This stamp duty value that you are talking about, it, I will say, the qualifying amount of SDV. What I'm saying, this has to be as the qualifying amount of the SDV. Qualifying amount of the SDV. Now, what is this qualifying amount of the SDV? Qualifying amount of the SDV. It can be either this or this. So first of all, I need to identify what will be my qualifying amount of the SDV. What would be my qualifying amount of the SDV, which I'm going to compare with? Compare with what? Compare with 105% of the consideration received or accruing as a result of the transfer. And therefore, my first step would be the qualifying amount of the SDV. See, as I told you, either this qualifying amount of the SDV can be point number A or it can be point number B. See point number A. If the date of the agreement is different from the date of transfer, and whole or part of the consideration is received by way of the account payee, check or bank draft or ECS, or through such other prescribed electronic mode on or before the date of the agreement. So you should receive consideration. You should receive the consideration. Now, whatever consideration that you have received, whether that consideration is a whole amount or whether that consideration is a part amount, that should be received by you through the electronic means. And by when you should be receiving this particular consideration by electronic means? On or before the due date, or on or before the date of the agreement. On or before the date of the agreement. Again, I'm repeating this particular point, so you have to be very careful about it. There has to be first receipt of the consideration. So the following condition will have to be satisfied if the qualifying amount of the SDV, shall be taken as the SDV on the date of agreement. Shall be taken as what? SDV, as on the date of agreement. So what is that condition that has to be satisfied? Condition number one, the consideration should have been received by the SSE. That consideration should have been received by the SSE either in whole or in part. Second, the consideration should have been received by the SSE on or before the date of the agreement. And third, that consideration which has been received on or before the date of the agreement should be received through the electronic means. If all these three conditions are satisfied, then and only then the qualifying amount of the stamp duty value will be taken as the value as on the date of the agreement. But you default in any of the condition, then in that case, the qualifying amount of the SDV will be taken, or the qualifying amount of the SDV will be taken as what? As the value on the date of transfer and not as on the date of agreement. This is the difference. So that is, if you default in any of the three conditions. Which are the three conditions? Can you repeat that three condition? Condition number one is, you should have received the consideration either in whole or in part. Point number two is, that consideration means whatever you have received, either in whole or in part, should be received on or before the date of the agreement. And third one is, our consideration so received should only be by electronic means. So if you satisfy all the three conditions, then in that case, the SDV, the qualifying amount of the SDV, will be the value as on the date of agreement. But you make the default, any one default in this, then the qualifying amount of the SDV will be the value as on the date of transfer. Now students, please be careful. Chances are very high in the examination, 90% or maybe 95%, they will not test you. They will not test you to determine which stamp duty value should be taken. Whether the stamp duty value should be taken as on the date of agreement or it should be taken as the date of the transfer. But there is 5% chance, students. There is 5% chance which they definitely can test you in the examination, whereby they will try to invoke this concept in the question, maybe through an MCQ route, maybe through that practical question, whereby they will give you that two SDV value, one as on the date of agreement, another the date of the transfer. And also they will give you this condition that whether the consideration whole or in part has been received through electronic means. So then you need to decide what, should I take my qualifying amount of SDV as on the date of agreement or as on the date of transfer? So choose that first, your qualifying amount of the SDV. Choose that particular qualifying amount of your SDV first. Once you have taken your qualifying amount of the SDV, then you compare Compare with what? Whatever consideration that you have received, top it up with 5% more. So 105% of that consideration will then be compared with this qualifying amount of the SDV. If it is higher, qualifying amount of the SDV is higher, then the full value of consideration that you are going to take would be the stamp duty value. Which stamp duty value? The qualifying amount of the SDV. But if you say that no sir, we are not satisfying the condition, the qualifying amount of the SDV is less than or equal to 105% of the consideration so received, then in that case the full value of consideration would be students would be what? The consideration so received. This is where the provision ends, students. This is where the provision ends. Now this is the special part. Now students, you may know now, because of the COVID times, you are very much aware what that this stamp duty value may be. See, stamp duty value which is there, they don't change frequently. That is an only an annual event that they will revise the stamp duty value. So that stamp duty value does not changes that frequently. However, what changes is the fair market value. What changes is the fair market value, because of the COVID issues and all, we all are aware that the real market fair market value has crashed down significantly. Now people today are being found that who are in dire or desperate need of the money, they are selling some of the real estate. Now the real estate that they are selling, they are getting a money, the fair market value which is there presently at which they are getting their consideration is much lower as compared to the SDV. So here the SSE will say that look, in today's time it is so tough for me that the fair market value I'm not even getting equal to what? Equal to the SDV. So kindly don't put an additional load now. First of all, already this COVID time has crippled my spine, and now we are putting an additional load on me. So therefore the SSE can accordingly will make a reference to the assessing officer suggesting him that look, the fair market value of this particular property is much lower as compared to the qualifying amount of the SDV. So kindly adopt for me as fair market value as my full value of consideration instead of adopting the qualifying amount of the SDV. This sort of an application will be made. And accordingly, students, you need to just finish it off only up till here. Rest of it you have to ignore. And what is that you need to look upon? Let's have a look. If the assessing officer refers the valuation to a valuation officer on the SSE's claim that the stamp duty value, again I'm repeating the same thing, this stamp duty value is which stamp duty value? Qualifying amount of the SDV. First you have to choose between the two, that the qualifying amount of the SDV exceed the FMV of the property on the date of the transfer. So what the AO will do, he will then refer on the application received by the AO from the SSE. What the assessing officer will do, he will then refer the matter to the valuation officer, who is an expert, who will do the valuation and will see that whether the SSE's claim that the fair market value of the property is much lower as compared to the stamp duty value, is that claim correct? So that is what the SSE will do. So if you see point number A, if valuation by the valuation officer is greater than the stamp duty value, if valuation by the valuation officer is greater than the SDV, then in that case, meaning thereby, if the FMV is greater than the SDV, is that is the final report of the valuation officer, then you cannot say now I'll take FMV. So now you cannot put the SSE into two minds that if I go there and if somehow FMV will be higher than the SDV, then the AO will take FMV as the basis. No, he will not do that. So here if you see point number A, if the valuation by the valuation officer is greater than the stamp duty value, again I'm repeating, the stamp duty value is the qualifying amount of the stamp duty value. So he will restrict it to stamp duty value. But where the valuation by the valuation officer is less than the stamp duty value, then in that situation, students, what you are going to say? Valuation would be as per whatever is the valuation report, because then they will accept that yes, SSE is right. The today's price, the value of this property is much lower than what? The qualifying amount of the SDV. The qualifying amount of the SDV. So definitely I will not put SSE with further burden, and hence the full value of consideration in this particular case will be taken as the value by the violation officer. Will be taken as what? As the value by the violation officer. That is it, students. So we are done with this particular capital gains topic now. So congratulations to all of you. And now with that, as I have told you, the IFOs part, which I'll just run through only from this chart. See, this particular chart would be helpful for you to do a quick revision for the capital gains for all these sections and all that we have done. Coming on to the IFOs, the page number for the IFOs. Yes. Students, just focus on the gift tax. First, here. So students, herein, see here. Now the gift can be received by you, students. The gift can be received by you either of the money or of the movable property. You'll say, sir, what is movable property? So all the movable property, simply put, these are the movable property. Okay, understand one thing, movable property, which is equal to, simply put, which is equal to a capital asset, which is equal to a capital asset. That is how it goes. If you see all that, be it shares, be it jewelry, be it archaeological collection, drawings, paintings, sculpture, any work of art, bullion, they are all nothing but a capital asset. And according, they are the movable property. So if you'll see here, in the case of a movable property, there are two things: without the consideration, and second one is inadequate consideration. So students, primarily, supposingly, I'll just to start off with the discussion, I'm getting, there is a notion that you add 1 rupee extra, it is considered as a good omen. You add that 1 rupee extra, that is considered as a very good omen. So therefore, I'm getting a gift from a friend of rupees 50,000 1 rupee. 50,000 1 rupee, I have got the gift. And if I'm getting a gift of 50,000 1 rupee, gone. Why gone? Whole of the amount, can you see point number one for the money part, whole of the amount, if the same is exceeding rupees 50,000, so you will not do like 50,001, so 1 rupee excess is taxable. No, it is not excess, the entire amount is taxable. And that is the irony of the situation. The entire amount, students, is taxable. And that is how it goes for the gift in money. Fine, so make no mistake on this particular part. Point number two, movable property, again I'm repeating on this one, movable property, students, is only in respect of those which constitute the capital asset. They may try to confuse you in the examination by suggesting that motor car, a seized motor car, you have received motor car as a gift. So if you are receiving the motor car as your gift, you can easily see that motor car, students, is a personal effect. And being a personal effect, we all do know that personal effect is not a capital asset. But so personal effect is not a capital asset. And that is the reason why it is not considered over here. So only those particular movable property which can constitute a capital asset as per the definition under section 2 clause 14, which can constitute a capital asset as per the definition of section 2 clause 14, shall only be considered while deciding the chargeability. And if you can see over here, point number two, movable property, point number one, without the consideration, the aggregate fair market value of the property if it exceeds rupees 50,000. Point number two, inadequate consideration, the difference between the aggregate fair market value and the consideration if such difference exceed rupees 50,000. So this movable property, if you see, it will then be in this regard. First is without the consideration, and second is the inadequate consideration. So the entire fair market value, please understand, it is an aggregate part. So what do you mean by the aggregate fair market value here, insurance? Aggregate fair market value would mean, supposingly, just I'm giving you an example, I have got two jewelries as a gift. Now the two jewelries which I have got a gift, one is of 30,000, another is also of 30,000. So if I do the aggregate, it will become as 60. So in that case, because it exceeds 50,000, so accordingly it will be chargeable to me under the head IFOs, being the recipient of those particular gift items. So the fact that they are talking about the aggregate of the fair market value, you need to take the aggregate part. But now, students, you have to be very careful. I have got 30,000 worth of the jewelry from my friend as a gift, and 30,000 worth of the jewelry I have received from my parents again as a gift. Now, if you know that for parents primarily, you will find there are certain exclusion herein. There are certain exclusion, students, wherein gift received from the relatives, you will find below in the chart, same chart below itself, gift which is received from the relatives in this regard primarily will be considered, will not be considered for the purpose of the chargeability. So that will not be considered for the purpose of chargeability. It is not chargeable to capital gains tax. So just be very clear on that particular part. So if I'm receiving the gift from my relatives, then, and certain occasions also, like even from friends, certain occasions like the marriage is one of the occasions, or through the will gift like that, if I have received through the will from my, again, relatives, those will not be chargeable in that regard. So when I'm getting a 30,000 worth of jewelry from my parent, in that case, it will not be chargeable to the capital gains in the hands of the recipient, that is me, and hence only 30,000 will then be considered. Now, whether the 30,000 has exceeded the threshold of 50,000, whether the 30,000, did it exceed the threshold of 50,000? And the answer is no. The fact that it has not exceeded the threshold of 50,000, therefore, nothing is chargeable. Okay, so that is what you have to be very careful about it. So take in that 50,000 limit only that gift cases. You will take only those gift cases which is not excluded. Now, what is excluded? I have told you about the list. So the what is excluded primarily? The list of the exclusions herein, we all know. So this is all the exclusion. Gift not taxable in the case of marriage, death of the donor, will or inheritance from the relatives and all. So in that particular case, or from the trust primarily. Okay, so this is what you should always keep in mind. So just, you can just confine yourself only to up till here. So if this is the event, then in that case, this is the exclusion. And accordingly, please don't consider this exclusions while you decide the limit of 50,000. Please don't consider these list of exclusions while you decide the limit of 50,000. And that is the reason why in this example which I have given you, jewelry of 30,000 I have received from a friend, not on marriage, not on these occasions which are there in the exclusion. So it is a taxable category. But at the same time, I have received 30,000 of the same gift from my parents, being a relative, according that is in the exclusion side. So my, because it is in the exclusion side, I will not consider that 30,000. So what is left for me is only 30. And therefore, the fact that this 30 does not exceed the threshold of 50,000, therefore, we will say and conclude what? That the chargeability will not be attracted in this particular case. Now, somebody will say, sir, what if I have got 30,000 of cash from a friend as a gift and 30,000 of jewelry from a friend as a gift? So will I tax this particular thing? What is your answer, students? 30,000 cash gift and 30,000 gift of jewelry. So question to all of you, therefore, is, will I then this be taxable? that's only two gifts which I received from a friend, and that is not on account of marriage or these exclusion categories. Will this be taxable? That is the question. Quickly. Quickly, students. Gopal, Priya, Trinath. And the answer is no, it will not be taxable, because aggregate that you all are supposed to do is not the aggregate of all the three categories. No. In fact, the aggregate concept is applicable only in 1 and 2. So that is one thing that you have to do it distinctively. So for 1, you will do the aggregate separately, and then you see whether it crosses the threshold of 50,000. For 2, you will do the aggregate. For 2, you will do the aggregate separately, and then you will see whether it crosses the threshold of 50,000. That is how you have to do it. Did you got this one? So in the first case, you have received the cash gift from your friend. In the second case, you have received the jewelry from your friend. As I told you, for each compartment, you have to do the aggregate, and that aggregate should cross by more than rupees 50,000. So since it is not crossing the threshold of 50,000, therefore, we will say and conclude that the gift will not be taxable in the hands of the recipient. Okay, so please do the aggregate for each of the compartments separately, not the aggregate of all the compartments. There are three compartments in all. Now, again, one more point, please pay attention to this one. The aggregate concept, students, you will do only for first two compartments individually. The aggregate that you will do will be for first two compartments individually. You'll say, sir, what about the third compartment? By the way, what is third compartment? Third compartment is immovable property. So for immovable property, you will test the threshold of 50,000. You will test the threshold of 50,000 individually. You will test the threshold of 50,000 individually, meaning thereby for each real estate transaction, you'll test the threshold of 50,000 individually. So supposedly, just a very hypothetical example, I'm just giving a very hypothetical example, and that is, say for example, I am getting two pieces of land, in which the first one, and as a gift, the first one, the stamp duty value is 40,000 rupees, and another one, the stamp duty value is 40,000 rupees, and that I have received from a friend. Will I then take the aggregate? And the answer is no. Only for the third category, students, only for the third category, you don't do the aggregate. For each of the real estate transaction, you'll have to look into it separately. But for the first two category, you will do the aggregate of that particular category. Meaning for money, you'll do the aggregate of all the money. For movable property, you'll do the aggregate of all the movable property. But for the third category, you don't do the aggregate concept. You will take for each real estate transaction and just see whether it exceeds the threshold of 50,000 or not. And that exactly is the point. Now, one is about, students, if the first case, if you see for the immovable property, the first that you can see for the immovable property would be without the consideration. And if it is without the consideration, you can see for yourself that the stamp duty value of the property, if it exceeds rupees 50,000. So if it is exceed rupees, so obviously all the stamp duties of a real estate will exceed if I'm receiving for free. Second one is a game. So second one is a point which you should be very careful about it. And what is that? Inadequate consideration. And what is this inadequate consideration? The difference between the stamp duty value. Now this stamp duty value is again the qualifying amount of the stamp duty value which we have just learnt in 50C. But they will not test you in the examination to that extent. So just stamp duty value. So I am a buyer and I did a very good bargaining from the seller. You are the seller. Okay. So the stamp duty value of this property, students, was say rupees 40 lakhs. And taking the advantage of the COVID times, I got this property bargained from you at rupees 30 lakhs. 30 lakhs. Now you tell me, students, in this case, what the difference is, how much? 10 lakhs. The difference is how much? 10 lakhs. Is this difference of 10 lakhs, is it greater than 50,000? Yes. Is it also greater than 5% of the consideration amount? Is it also greater than the 5% of the consideration amount? How much consideration did I pay to you? 30 lakhs. What is the 5% of the consideration amount? 1.5 lakhs. So is this difference of 10 lakhs greater than rupees 1.5 lakhs? Yes, it is greater than rupees 1.5 lakhs. So if it is greater than both 50,000 rupees, as well as it is also greater than what? 5% of the consideration amount, then in such case the entire difference amount, students, it will be charged in my hands under the head IFOS. It will be charged in my hands under the head IFOS. Now the beauty, I'll tell you, students, if you can appreciate what I'm going to talk right now with all of you, although it may not be relevant for your examination, but still I'll speak with you. The beauty in this case is this. You are a seller, for example. You are a seller and you got what? 30 lakh rupees. Stamp duty value was 40 lakhs. You have the option that you can go to the assessing officer. Just now we read this one. That you can go to the assessing officer, make an application to the assessing officer and ask him and plead and request before him that the fair market value in the COVID times is much lesser as compared to the stamp duty value. What the assessing officer will do for you, he will refer your matter to the valuation officer, and based on the valuation officer report, he will allow you to take the FMV as the full value of consideration. And if the FMV is say 30 lakhs, so what happens? You will calculate your capital gains now on 30 lakhs. Okay, so you are spared. You are spared. Being a seller, you are spared. But what about for me as a buyer? Do I also get the chance to make an application to the assessing officer and pleading him that look, 30,000 is because it's a COVID time and the real estate market is, I cannot pay 40 lakhs when the fair market value is at 30 lakhs. I being the buyer, I cannot pay 40 lakhs when the fair market value of this property is 30 lakhs. So therefore I have paid him only 30 lakhs as the fair market value of this property. So when I'm paying him 30 lakhs, then you are taking the difference, stamp duty value versus what you have paid. And that difference, because it exceeded 50,000 and because it also exceeded 5% of consideration, the entire difference of rupees 10 lakhs you are charging to me under the head, under which head? IFOS. This is the, you can say, a kind of the injustice. Because seller gets protection that he can make an application to the AO and get the FMV as his full value of consideration. I don't get the protection. And for me, they will keep on comparing the SDV with the consideration paid, and the difference they will compare with rupees 50,000 and 5% of the consideration. And if it is higher, then entire difference would be charged to me in the head IFOS. Did you all got this one, students? So this is how you should always keep your, this is the two sides of the coin. The unfairness of the taxation law. For the seller, what is the position? And for the buyer, what is the position? Fine. So these are the two sides of the coin, students, which has been there. My humble request to all of you would be to quickly go through whatever IFOs in the module question. In the module, whatever is the gift tax question, please do that. And that is it. Apart from that, I will just see, maybe in the next class we'll touch upon something about a dividend or so, and then I'll switch to the next topic, students, that is TDS. As per the popular request, TDS, advance tax and interest, is what I'm going to do it in my next session, because I may not know whether I will be continuing for maybe one more topic or so after TDS. So that is how we are going to put it end to our this revisionary concept. So TDS, TCS and advance tax is what I'm going to do with you, and thereafter one more topic, okay, of your choice. So that is how we are going to wrap it up our segment. So students, tomorrow also I will be trying to put across a message in your group. If it is early 7:30, I'll accordingly will do it in 7:30 itself, because we have to be on the con calls now, because all the members are also free only at 9 o'clock or so. So that's the time, okay. So please ensure one thing last, which is about two things. One is the IFOS gift tax question. Please do that. It is going to be there in your examination without fail. It is going to be there, students, in the examination without fail. Okay, so please ensure to do that gift tax question. Fine. So students, see you then tomorrow. I'll just update you in the group, and accordingly we'll start on that one. 7:30, it can be, highly chances are there it will be in 7:30, but If nothing is there, because tomorrow being a Sunday, we'll continue at 9. Depends what happens tomorrow.